Healing the Earth is brought to you in part by grants from these individuals and organizations.
Mother Nature, she can take us or leave us. We told her we loved her, but she didn't believe us. We've got this planet of ours running a fever. She tried to warn us, but we did not believe her.
Dancer, she moves like a dancer, spinning through space, power and grace, shimmering bright.
This is a story about our lives and our children's future. About maintaining our health and the health of our planet at the most basic level. It's a story about how to solve one of the most crucial problems the Earth has ever faced in a way that benefits everyone, everywhere.
Planet, blue water planet.
We are all interlinked in one way or another, the soil, the plants, the animals, and the human beings. We have a common link. And we have to take care. And the human being has been endowed with the capabilities of managing.
The rivers are lifeblood, through land they roam, grass in the heart, soil is the soul.
The biggest problem as I see it with the way we're managing our land today is probably we're ignoring the soil surface. We're more focused on production and dollars and cents, and the soil surface really is the key to everything.
Mother sings to her children, sings of rebirth, healing the earth, fertile and whole.
Healing the land is absolutely vital to the survival of humanity now. Land degradation, desertification, call it what you will, has destroyed more civilizations in history than armies have done.
For thousands and thousands of years, we've been repeating the mistake and constantly going to new territories, degrading them, moving on, but we're running out of earth.
Now, we've taken away the different kind of grass, we've taken away the different kinds of animals, we've taken away the different kinds of plants. We've created desert by the way we are behaving towards the soil.
Hand in hand, join the forces of nature.
It's crucial, it's really crucial because we need to understand, whether we live in the city or we live in rural areas, that the land, it's really what is sustaining us.
You could say 50 to 80% of the carbon worldwide has been lost from topsoil. It's a fairly staggering amount. And we're talking about all the excess carbon dioxide that we have in the air.
We know with rock solid observational evidence that all the rise in CO2 since the pre-industrial times, a couple hundred years ago, was due to human activities.
So now humans have completely taken over. We are determining the atmospheric composition, and we are determining future climate.
Basically, you can think of plants as a sort of bridge that connects atmospheric CO2 with soil carbon.
Grazing on grasses, hooves cut the earth, land in rebirth, the cycle unfolds.
We farmers are in the beautiful position of being the custodians of the photosynthesis process that will remove CO2 from the air.
This is a story about a few small millimeters, how we can heal them and ultimately heal the earth.
If we're talking about farmland ecology or soil or nature. The big problem is people's minds, how they think, how we're brought up to relate. It's easy to see the environment as an enemy, especially when it's harsh. And to look and to be harsh towards it. Australian farming was headed in one direction, out the door. 50% of our topsoil has been lost since Captain Cook arrived. Of what's left, 75% of its soil organic matter has been lost. Doesn't that say something? You'd think they would stop industrial agriculture entirely and reverse the gears and go back in another direction. But humans are very habituated to the past.
Children have an ability to cut through politics, the past, and prejudice. They see the truth, and we need to listen.
The earth is important because you get to grow your crops and it helps you to survive.
The land is so important to me because it gave me food, and that's where we build our houses.
You gotta take care of the land because we're not just the only ones living here. There's animals and there's gonna be people in the future, and if we don't take care of it now, there's not gonna be any left for anyone else to live on.
It's very important to take care of the land because there's a lot of plants that don't have water and we need to make reservoirs.
I think it's important to do all those things because when I grow up, the world will be a cleaner place.
People need to understand that the land is not a renewable resource, that once it's gone, it's gone.
Land is important. All things are come from the land.
Around the world, the message is the same.
The fact that ranching heals the earth, and if done properly, can regenerate grasslands and watersheds. To us, that's not news, but it's exciting that other people are catching on to that, and that cattle in particular aren't being blamed or thought of as the cause of global warming, but actually a solution to it. Not only is this a viable choice, but something that we can make a difference with, and our lives can really improve the health of the earth and make this a better place. It gives our work meaning. There's actual societal benefits for ranching.
Yo tengo agarrada la yegua.
¿Y en qué se fue, Marco?
Our neighbors, you know, they're just grazing and reaping the land and taking a lot of kilos of beef to the market. But they don't look where the cows are standing, the ecology of the soil of the place, and we need to learn where the cows are standing at, and that by that I mean the ecology of the place, you know, the land itself. Some cycles take months or weeks. Some bioecological cycles take years. Some cycles take decades. So this is an intergenerational effort, you know. Some stuff of what we're planning to, we're not going to be able to see them in our own existence, but that's why we have to work with kids, because some of the cycles take decades, you know.
I firmly feel that if we don't think about our future, and I think that's to do with healing the land too, if we're not constantly being caretakers of this land, nothing is really ours. It's all here for us to look after. And if we don't care for it, who will?
I do feel a responsibility to hand this land on in a way that I believe is healthier, more productive, and with greater biodiversity, and hopefully with a considerable increase in topsoil to my children.
Which is the interconnection with the rest of the world, isn't it? I mean, if we do our little bit here and somebody else does their little bit in another country, it must all eventually link up.
Our offspring will still use the same land generations and generations. It is very important that you should keep it to repair what you have torn, which means when you till the land, you are eroding it. So you should also increase fertility, the soil fertility. You have healthy land and you have a lot of grass growing up and water table raises up because of that. It's a matter of healing your own land, because we are preserving it for the future generation, not for ourselves.
That's the treasure, and the biggest treasure that we're leaving for our kids and our neighbors' kids is the knowledge. The knowledge, the capacities, the knowledge, the experiences that it can be done. You know, you just need to commit to it.
What am I talking about when I'm saying healing the land? Well, what I'm talking about is literally the soil surface, that very top, the interface between the earth and the air. At that soil surface, we need to keep that covered in litter, organic matter, and we're looking to probably have an inch, 25 millimeters of cover over the soil. And that litter is like your skin, my skin. If we were to lose our skin, it would hurt. It'd hurt like hell. If you create bare soil, exposed soil, then that's exactly the same thing for the land. It's hurting like hell. There's no protection for the microorganisms, there's no protection for the water. The soil starts to get capped or hard and it becomes like an asphalt surface, and water runs off instead of going into the soil. Productivity goes down and the problems gradually over time just get worse and worse and worse. Ecosystem function is degrading rather than improving.
It began long ago and everywhere. It was a result of trying too hard. And now, due to human nature, we have trouble pulling away from the past and embracing a future that could save us.
I think before we abused the land to the extent it was at now, it was more resilient. We didn't have to pay attention to it. I think now as we get production issues, pest issues, we're looking at what's the root cause, and I think we're finding that it's our management of the land that's really having a huge impact. And so now we're kind of going back and saying, well, so how else should we be managing the land?
About 95% of Australia is brittle tending, and worldwide about two-thirds of the world is brittle tending. And in brittle tending environments, what we have done is impose European management processes to Australia, and Europe is essentially a non-brittle environment. And the behaviour of nature in non-brittle environments is very different to the behaviour of nature in brittle environments. And what we have done is inadvertently used non-brittle management techniques in brittle environments and degraded the land.
In 95, in right before May, June of 95, before the monsoons, it was tough because we could see the cows dying and we didn't know what to do with them. They had nothing to eat, and it was sad. It was sad.
Our soil was buggered. At 80 years of synthetic fertilizers and high use of pesticides and herbicides and tillage, you know, wet tillage, dry tillage, all that sort of thing. You know, when I was a kid, I didn't think you were working hard unless you're sitting on a tractor with dust all over your face.
2 decades ago, I was a cowboy in Nevada and a young man, and I really didn't even think too much about the health of the land. I sort of took it for granted that the land would be there, and it was beautiful or it wasn't, and there was grass or there wasn't. And I really didn't think too much about how management or my role affected the health of the land.
We cleared the land totally. We denuded land in the 70s totally here. That's a way of doing range work back in the 70s. you know, get rid of the trees, get rid of the shrubs, and plant grasses. The traditional way of thinking back then in the 60s, 70s, and around their range resource managers, it's if you want healthy grasslands, you have to get rid of trees and shrubs. So we pay close attention to that, and we denuded almost the whole ranch from trees and shrubs. Fortunately, all of this is renewable.
Our system of agriculture, you know, industrial agriculture, it's such a high input system. It's almost like we feel as if we're not being a farmer, we're not doing the, you know, we're being negligent if we're not using lots of the inputs, and they're not only they're expensive, but they're all going to have an effect. Sometimes good, sometimes not so good.
Well, it's been known for several decades that nitrogen fertilizer use emits nitrous oxide, which is a very potent greenhouse gas. In fact, on a per molecule basis, it's much more powerful than the most important greenhouse gas that humans release, which is CO2.
What we were doing was unsustainable, we believe, because we were applying large amounts of inorganic fertilizer, of chemicals. Input costs were rising, profits were diminishing. But I think more importantly, we were eating the heart out of this fragile country.
I think the big problem with modern agriculture systems is that we're actually fighting nature. We're enemy farming instead of working with nature. Even the names of the chemicals that we use are names like grenade and stomp, stampede, fusillade. You know, it's like the enemy's out there, and if we don't beat it, well, we're going to go broke and we're going to have to leave the land. But it's quite the opposite.
We're always worried about financial performance, and we always think that if we do less, we're going to be not having enough. But in actual fact, we've found almost the opposite. We've found that by treading more lightly on the landscape, our business has actually got stronger, because we're working with the way the land functions rather than trying to impose this regime upon it that is really acting antagonistically with it.
You know, we haven't used any insecticides in our livestock since 1986. That's already almost 22 years. You know, we have a clean fields. Most of our neighbors, most of the people around, they still are using insecticides, which, by the way, if you use that poor on insecticides, you know, you won't have these insects, these termites doing the job that they're cycling and decomposing, completing the cycle. We need the insects. We need the decomposers, you know, like termites help out in breaking down fiber that wasn't broken down by the rumen of the cows, okay, of the ruminants. You know, that's the job of the termites. They continue doing the decomposition in order to complete the cycle and have relatively fertile soil to have new growth happening.
At least it helps the family to get going during the dry months.
You can never separate people from their land. You can never talk about livestock without talking about the land and the people. You can never separate biodiversity loss and desertification, because that is showing that there's something wrong with the ecosystem processes. When you look at the ecosystem, look at it as a whole. Don't split things, because you'll never really get to the bottom of the matter.
For amber waves of grain,
I guess I would say I love this land.
There's not a lot of people here, and it's really pretty, and you can just go on walks anywhere and just like enjoy it, because it's not like any place else really. It's just kind of unique in its own way.
We have to take care of the land, because if we don't, then everything just dies and the topsoil will blow away, so that no other plants can grow.
That'd be sad.
From sea to shining sea.
One of the keys to the solution requires viewing the problem in a way that challenges our predecessors' thoughts and ideas. But once we fully understand how and why we need to change our view, the method of healing becomes evident.
People are all wondering, how are we going to feed the increased population all over the world? Well, if we look to our soils again, we became technologically very good, but we forgot some of the basics. And so the basics is get back to the soil, get back to the very thing that without the soil, civilizations can fail. If the soil fails and it erodes or it becomes dead, then how do you feed your people? You can't feed your people without the soils.
See how many animals are in that paddock, and they've probably been there for quite some time. For an area like that to be looking like it does, nothing short of criminal. Too many animals for too long. You won't get a better example of degradation than that today. All of those tracks just create perfect erosion gullies to start off with, and on this light soil, it'll just be flowing down the creek.
We have tended to want to build fences, and instead of having large herds tightly compacted, we've tended to put small numbers of animals into a large number of paddocks at very low densities for a very long period of time. And the effect of that is several. First of all, their plants are exposed to animals for a long period of time. So if a plant gets bitten today, it starts to regrow a little bit and gets bitten again in a week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks, and that constant rebiting before it's had time to grow back up its growth curve means that it is overgrazed. That's what overgrazing is, and overgrazing is literally a second bite of a plant before it's fully recovered from a previous bite.
We are probably about a kilometre or so from the water here, and animals have been here over and over and over repeatedly. So you end up with bare ground, a few weeds, stubs of completely overgrazed plants, grass plants trying to grow. This is what happens when we create national parks and make animals tame and static. You can see them there day after day after day. And bear in mind that we are seeing this at the best time of the year, at the end of the rains, in a very good rainy season. So if you see this later in the year, it's a wonder any animals can stay alive.
In Australia, what we've seen is overgrazing and massive amounts of overrest. The predominant tool that's being used in Australia and our rangelands, on about 460 million hectares of it, is rest, as overrest. And that, in a brittle tending environment, and the more brittle you are, the more damaging, is causing plant deaths, bare soil, erosion, dust storms, loss of productivity of the land, loss of profitability of the farmers, and a need for billions of dollars of government aid to keep the agricultural sector going. And that's what's been happening in Australia and elsewhere in the world.
All that's gone wrong on this land is that people are running the conventional way, believing that overgrazing is controlled by animal numbers. So for many, many years, government has tried to limit the numbers that the animals have, but limiting the numbers doesn't help at all. The people just get poorer and poorer, and the land suffers more from greater degree of partial rest because they're inadequate grazing animals to keep the grassland alive. And then where the few animals do concentrate, like this, on the best soils, they do what we see here, overgraze every plant, damage the rivers.
And you can keep destocking and destocking and destocking, and the land just keeps getting worse. So it doesn't matter whether we're looking at a developed country or an undeveloped country, the principle is the same.
Throughout the world, for thousands of years, fire has been used as a tool to clear land. In addition to a different form of animal management, controlling fire is essential, not only to the health of the land, but to the health of the atmosphere.
The average American has a personal carbon footprint that's on the order of 6 tons per person per year. So that your activities, your home, your car, the things you buy represent a release of something like 6 tons of carbon to the atmosphere. A rich tropical forest might have a standing crop in the trees of 300 tons of carbon per hectare, per 2.5 acres, or about 100 tons of carbon per acre. What that means is that a fire of a single acre in a tropical forest releases as much carbon as a typical American would release in about 16 years of activity. It doesn't take very much land being consumed in fire to really distort the carbon budget. And we've had several incidents recently in the U.S. where states with big wildfires ended up with the carbon footprint of the wildfires in a given year being bigger than the carbon footprint of all the people.
Unfortunately, what had caused this river to go dry was too few animals wandering around and fire. And this land had been burnt year after year after year as a matter of government policy, national parks policy, forestry policy. Major environmental organizations support the use of fire. We've pretty well stopped it now, other than for our fire breaks. And so a major part of the recovery of this river is just stopping the fires.
One of the ways that fires can influence climate is by releasing carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas, and more heat is trapped when the carbon from a forest is released to the atmosphere. But another way that carbon from fires can influence climate is by leaving a black soil. You know, the temperature of the earth is strongly controlled by how much of the sun's energy is absorbed at the surface. And a black surface absorbs a lot more energy than a light surface. So when you've got an area like the area we're in now that's covered with charcoal, you end up with warmer surface temperatures transferring more heat to the air.
It is possible to return to animal-maintained savannas and grasslands instead of savannas and grasslands subjected to partial rest, overgrazing of plants, and attempting to maintain them with fire, which is what humans have done for the last 50,000 years or so. This used to burn year after year after year to try to maintain grassland, etc. We've kept the fires out, and we've used the cattle and the buffalo and the elephant to replace the role of the fire.
Important because animals and people depend on it.
When we burn different things like clothes and so forth, it will make up the ozone layer to lose its function.
Land is also important in our future because we have trees and grasses which gives us oxygen.
I love this land.
I love the land.
When the land can no longer maintain crops, civilizations disappear for lack of food. Today, there is an additional reason to maintain the soil. Whether or not global warming is real, whether man is to blame or not, caution would suggest that we take what steps we can to remove carbon dioxide from the air. And by so doing, we also benefit the topsoil, the plants, and ourselves.
We're all going to have to pay, somehow or other, to remove carbon from the atmosphere and to prevent carbon going into the atmosphere. It costs more. Currently, it doesn't cost very much to release carbon. There's no price on carbon. Around in Australia, in America, in China, in India. And once there's a price on carbon, we will all become part of a carbon economy. And it will affect everything we do. It won't mean a disaster. It'll just mean things that were inexpensive will become expensive.
Carbon in general is a fundamental element of the universe, of course, right? And it's a fundamental element of all life on Earth. And without carbon, there would be no life. Carbon, in terms of climate change, is important because we know that carbon gases in the atmosphere, most notably methane and CO2, are causing the vast majority of the global warming.
What we realize is that the increase of CO2 that humans have caused from 280 to 385 parts per million is already enough to get us into the dangerous zone. If we were just to leave it at 385 and leave it there for many centuries, we would melt most of the glaciers around the world, mountain glaciers around the world. We would lose all the ice in the Arctic sea ice in the warm season. We would cause a lot of problems. So if we want to preserve a climate like the one that we've known for the last 10 to 12,000 years, we probably have to decrease CO2 at least back to 350, and probably even somewhat lower than that, closer to what it was before we started to mess with the system. But that's still possible because, you know, the ocean and the soils and the biosphere are taking up CO2. Our forestry practices and our agricultural practices could be modified to bring CO2 back down much more quickly. It's a natural type of geoengineering, but try to get the CO2 back where it came from. And that, I think, will be an important part of solving the problem.
You could say 50 to 80% of the carbon worldwide has been lost from topsoil. It's a fairly staggering amount.
Basically, you can think of plants as a sort of bridge that connects atmospheric CO2 with soil carbon. So really, when we're talking about land sequestration, we're talking about the two components. So the plant biomass, the above ground biomass, that's a vast storage of carbon. And that storage of carbon is about equal to the amount of carbon that's in the form of CO2 in the atmosphere. So it's about 800 billion tons of carbon in the form of CO2. That's stored in the atmosphere, and that's also stored in land plants in their biomass. And now, about double that much is stored in the soil on land globally. So the soil plus the land, in terms of carbon stocks, contain a combined factor of 3 higher than the atmospheric CO2 level.
When soils are managed carefully, when organic matter is returned to the soils, when runoff is prevented and erosion is prevented, soils can be managed to dramatically increase the amount of carbon they contain. Recent estimates are that we could be sequestering in soils worldwide something on the order of 1 to 2 billion tons per year of carbon with the best possible management techniques. That is a significant fraction of the approximately 10 billion tons that we're releasing to the atmosphere.
Crops are traditionally grown into bare soil, whether they're sprayed, whether the other plants are sprayed out, or whether they're cultivated. There's no green leaf, so carbon levels in Australian soils, when grasslands like this were opened up for cropping, they dropped to within about 50% of their original level within a couple of years. You just lost half of the carbon that you had there just by taking these grasses away and cultivating that soil.
We're talking about massive quantities of carbon being stored back in the soil where it should be, rather than in the atmosphere.
The fabulous thing about sequestering carbon in grasslands is that you can keep on doing it forever. You can keep on building soil on soil on soil on soil. Australian perennial grasses can live for 100 years. So these grasses can outlive their owners, basically. So they're longer lived than a lot of trees. The carbon is more permanent than it is in trees. It's not going to recycle back to the atmosphere if we maintain that management.
Mud.
And there is no limit to how much soil you can build.
Wow, look at the cover here.
For the future of the planet, it's crucially important because we can sequester all of the excess carbon dioxide that's in the atmosphere at the moment, what we call the legacy load, we can easily sequester in our soils. Australian soils, for example, we would only have to improve carbon percentage by 1% on our 450 million hectares of agricultural soil in Australia, and we could sequester all of the planet's legacy load of carbon. It's just, you know, it's quite a stunning figure.
There's really a large potential to store additional carbon in soils. You can think of soils as a bank account that has the capacity to really build up very large quantities of capital moving into the future.
Good dog. Good dog. Push him up.
We are concerned about climate change. We're concerned for lots of reasons, one of which is we have grandchildren. And so when we came to understand the role that soils could have in sucking carbon dioxide out of the air and taking the carbon back down into the ground, and the double benefits that that has, because when you do that, you increase your fertility, you increase, very importantly in Australia, your water holding capacity. And so it had these multiple benefits.
Plants have leaves, and the leaves are solar panels. They draw in the sun's energy. And the other thing that plants can do is suck in CO2. And separate the C from the O, release the O, and take the C into its leaves, down into its roots. Now, the process of manufacturing carbon in soil takes place when the plant is grazed. And let's say the plant is grazed to half its height, which is healthy. And then left. The roots die back proportionately, and the detritus that they leave behind unlocks a frenzy of feeding and fecundity among the microbiological communities. There are cities and villages and nations and an entire Star Wars of life forms that interact. Now, that's only the beginning, because when those leaves are left to grow out to their fullest extent, time is our most important tool. Those new roots for perennial plants go down and pierce through and open up the soil. And a magical thing happens. They start exuding fungus and other substances, which wakes up those communities, and we have another big party. And the side effect of this party, apart from a hangover for some of the microbes, is soil carbon. And the more we allow this pulsing of root, the more soil carbon we get. So that's why we've got to allow the plants time to recover. Some nights we can hear the thump, thump, thump of the disco.
Let me start with the sun, shining on a live soil which is covered with grass. Harvesting the solar energy, the grass is taking the solar energy from the sun. And with that, the grass grows. Then the cow comes to eat the grass. The cow grows from the grass. It gets fed. You look at it, you admire it, you say this is a healthy cow. Maybe it will reproduce because it's healthy. Or you want to do beef, you look at this healthy livestock and say, okay, now my beef is ready. You slaughter it. You do the different cuts of beef and take it to the supermarket. It all started with a healthy soil, harvesting the solar energy, making everything balanced with community dynamics.
By resuscitating the land, we make it function. For example, our tool here in the community is livestock. Then it also increases the fertility of the soil. As it increases the fertility of the soil, there's more grass, healthy cows, more vitamins and protein to people. That's how we get more food.
The beauty of this solution is its simplicity. It is utilizing what we already have in a way that saves money, feeds people, and heals the soil. It depends on animals, and it's currently happening around the world.
This is the poorest sand in the country. We are in the region 5, the poorest soil in the country. That's where we are. We call it region 5 in Zimbabwe. Actually, it's not fertile, it's poor land, you know. But it depends. If you don't come up with the right tools, you get nothing in this land, definitely nothing. And we don't have much rain in this region. So which means if you don't come up with better tools, you get nothing, completely nothing here. People don't even sell anything. They don't have enough food to sustain themselves.
In most places, people have been plowing in the fields for over many generations. And the nutrients in the soil get less and less and less. And that's why some fields become infertile. So to bring back the fertility, we are now using the tool of animals.
We use animals as our own tools to improve the soil fertility. Because you make sort of crawls, makeshift crawls. Yeah, we call the tools sleeping here, move them to other side. They break the soil and, you know, we have got a lot of manure, urine, which is like ammonium nitrite, bank it under the ground, they break the soil. And at the end of the day, you get a lot of from that. You heal the land. The right language is healing the land, and it becomes more better and better. Then you can get something out of it. These ones we use the traditional way of tilling. You can even tell that they are not quite healthy. These ones worse, no manure. So it can show the fertility of the soil that is quite different. These ones are far much better. It's a better school fees for us. We're using animals to improve the soil fertilities. This one is in a traditional way. Here we didn't put manure, and we've got look how little they are. So it makes a very big difference. So that's why you are saying, let's adopt this system of using animals to improve the soil fertility, which makes a great change. I think you can tell for yourself.
How difficult it is to convince the majority of the community to learn, because this is a lot of hard work. It deviates from what the community knows as a norm. So to teach an old horse new tricks, it always takes time. They are trying to coerce more people to listen by showing them the yield and what they have got. Now, those who did not plant using this method, they now look at this yield and, you know, they are jealous. They wish that they had listened, but it's already too late.
Monde is one of our pilot communities. Already we are working with an adjacent community of Sizinda. We've got two more communities about 160 kilometers from here. However, as we have already started working with these four pilot communities, we have got on a ripple effect. Other communities that are nearby already clamoring to say, can we also go for it? So, already communities are excited just looking at the results of what we are doing.
Because they are imparting this knowledge to their children and families, their children now know what brings water on board. Because they have water now, they have livestock, they have food. They feel so content, they think even the gates of heaven are open for them now. Because of this project, their children now know how important the soil is, how important water is. As a future generation, they have hope in their children that when they pass on, the children will remain implementing the knowledge. They are healing the land.
This ranch lies in the northwest edge of the Sonoran Plains in the central Sonora, state of Sonora in Mexico. According to ecologists, it's a savanna type, shrubs, trees, desert trees, and grasses. Most of these lands, desert lands, were kept bare soils. And what we're trying to do as seasons pass by is to cover more soil, keep maintaining, cover more soil with vegetation, dung, urine, grass, trample grass, whatever material that we can find in order to cover the soil with vegetation. It's a key. One of the best reclamation tools that we have found, it's the hooves and the mouths of our domestic animals. We use them, we control them in order to improve these basic ecological processes which we are managing. You know, water cycle, mineral cycle, energy flow, and the dynamics of our soils, our plants, the animals that consume all these vegetations, and ourselves as the manipulators of the whole.
Me sorprendió ver que especies naturales, especies nativas de la zona.
One thing that was surprising to me is that I found native species of plants that normally tend to be in riparian areas, near arroyos or slightly wet areas in the desert, were found here throughout the land.
En todos lados dentro del rancho. Debe ser.
I think it has to do with the special management that is going on in this ranch.
Los valores de densidad.
The values that we have gathered here that has to do with the frequency and the density and diversity of the ranch here are substantially higher than any of the nearby ranches.
We don't want to remove the trees. We want to promote the growth of trees and a diverse composition of flora. You know, all species are welcome. That helps the whole community. That helps the soils, that helps the grasses, the forbs, the herbs, the wildlife, our cattle, our horses, our stock.
I've been working in this land around 19, 20 years. The changes have been quite dramatic in a lot of them. From seeing almost completely bare land, practically naked, to seeing a land that has been almost covered, almost to its totality. It didn't have any ground cover before, and now it's covered almost completely.
ponemos en números,
if we put this into numbers, we're talking about going from 5 to 10% ground cover to 80 to 85% or ground cover.
Yeah, we're now standing close to the northern boundary of our property, our ranch. This is an area that is being grazed right now, severely grazed. We can see there's quite a bit of little mesquite trees blooming already, more amongst the litter of grass that is being left behind by the calves. We're gonna walk towards the boundary, the fence line of the ranch, and compare the scenery, the landscape, with our northern neighbor. This is a 220 hectare paddock in our side. This is an 11,000 hectare paddock. And as you can see, there's lots of bare soil, very few cattle hoof tracks in there, little grass, and lots of cactus.
Half a world away, the same problems persist.
We've created these parks, which are safe sanctuaries, and the elephants and the buffalo and whatever spend day after day after day there, and it's that that does the damage. You need to keep animals moving. It's very easy for people to understand. If you just took one animal every day to the riverbank, it would be one animal times 365 days, one animal by that. So it's 365 animal days of dunging, trampling, grazing, browsing. It would cause destruction, and we say there's too many animals. But if you brought 5,000 or 10,000 animals on one day, you'd have 10,000 animal days of grazing, browsing, trampling. It would look terrible on that day to anybody except a gardener, who would say, this is wonderful, you've got mulch and litter and soil cover and dung and urine. And if you let the same time lapse, a year lapse, it would be the greenest part of the land, healthiest part of the land. There never were too many animals. They've become too tame, too static. Wildlife is meant to be able to move freely. Now we've come to the edge of the park, and we're coming out of the park now, and if you look at the riverbanks, they're completely stable. And you've got a whole mix of vegetation. So now you're seeing reeds, grass, everything close to the water, trees, stable riverbanks, no erosion, as you get out of the park. Within 50 to 100 meters of getting out of the park boundary, animals will know that's a wild area. People will harass them if they go in there, so the vegetation doesn't get damaged.
While the animals are key, the human element, the management of the animals, is crucial.
Animals are absolutely critical to rehabilitating that land, and that's a very scary thing for people to get their mind around, that the things that caused the problem, or were perceived to have caused the problem, these animals, are in fact the only tool that we have that can fix the problem. But we've got to change their behaviours, but that means changing the behaviours of the humans first, so they can then go and change the behaviours of the things that make the land healthy.
So if we think about the needs of the animal, and then we go back to our resource of the land, of the grasses, and try to improve that. And so what we teach a farmer is to look at their grasslands, identify what grasses they have, how is it doing, what time of the year does certain grass species grow better than another time of the year. Then, by managing those livestock through the seasons of the year, when the grasses are growing the best in certain parts of their pastures, they're able to move their livestock to take the advantage of the grasses.
We're using the cattle as the main tool for wildlife habitat and management. We've got to be planning at least 6 months ahead all the time to know that we've got them in the right place for the right reason at the right time, so that they're never conflicting with the wildlife. They are just working to enhance the wildlife population. So we've had a very big buildup of most wildlife species since we've been doing this.
I think there's an incredible opportunity for environmentalists and ranchers and farmers to get together around this issue. I think that if you look at what each of them wants, what the environmentalists want and what the ranchers and farmers want, it's really the same thing. They want to have productive farms. They want to have healthy natural resources, healthy soil, healthy land, lots of vegetation, an absence of flooding. And so there is a path to that, and the path to that is through practices like planned grazing, where you're using the animals to actually improve the land. I mean, if you think about the past, when you had large herds of animals moving across the land, you also had grass that was chest high, especially out in the West. And there was a reason for that.
The bison have ranged over great grasslands up through Texas and Oklahoma, Kansas and Nebraska, in those great grasslands with native grass species. Always moving, always stirring the soil, never coming back to the area where they had been grazing before until sometime later, perhaps a season later, when the rains had done their thing to help the regeneration of the grasses.
Historically, healthy range and grasslands supported large herds, tightly packed, stirring the soil and constantly moving. It's a simple way to work with nature.
We run bison. We run about 1,200 breeding cows. We've got about 53,000 acres thereabouts that that the bison graze. The health of the land is imperative to what we do. And the health of the animals is imperative to what we do. It affects everything from your death loss to your productivity, your weaning weights, your conception rates. Everything is tied to the health of the land, absolutely. We're trying to simulate the way it was 300 years ago with the bison herds roaming. There were very large herds, and there were predators, and they functioned jointly, the predators helping to keep the buffalo in tighter groups, affecting the ground differently. They would keep the animals moving from place to place. Also, when you have large herds together, they would come into an area and graze it off fairly quickly because there's a lot of mouths eating, and so they would continually move on, therefore allowing the rest that's so necessary for the grasses to recover. The land needs the animal. The plants need the animal. They've evolved with the animal, the disturbance from the animals, in order to be healthy and vigorous. And we've definitely seen that by, using herd effect in certain areas. You see vigorous plant regrowth. The plants bounce back from disturbance like that. So seeing is believing, and definitely we've seen it and believe it. It makes perfect sense.
These methods are being used throughout the world, and farmers and ranchers are prospering.
But I'll be grazing them very soon, in the middle of March, I'd imagine.
There are a series of planning charts there. One is a stock plan, your breeding program, and how your numbers turn out with breeding and the end of the year and the start of a new year. And there's another plan there, which is the grazing chart, which is planning the movements of the animals to benefit the land, to regenerate the land, protect the grass plants that are growing daily or by the minute, because they're living things and we need to protect them. So we need to just have restricted time that animals are in the company of those plants. and plan to have enough forage to last our animals through a given period, maybe a winter period or hot summer period.
There you go. Come on, boys.
I started actually working here on my thesis in late 94. And what this area looked like was essentially lots of bare ground with frequent wiregrass tussocks. So wiregrass, which is not a particularly desirable species, was certainly the dominant plant that was in this particular area.
To me, we've got to start to think about managing the land for what it is, how it is, and how you know, we can't change it. We try to change things, but Mother Nature comes back and bites you twice as hard.
The question was, does changing the grazing management change the species diversity and the ground cover and what happens to the functioning of that landscape?
Like so?
The study was 3 years and came up with some pretty spectacular results.
I was mostly surprised at the speed at which the land changed. I wasn't surprised once you start to manage land in tune with nature and manage it in tune with the natural cycles, then phenomenal things can happen.
All that lovely green leaf underneath there.
Yep.
Yes.
Well, that's Mother Nature saying thank you very much.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, Tim.
It all comes back to the soil. The plants are really only an indication of what's happening in the soil.
Everyone's life depends on the soil. That soil has to be alive for us to live. It has to be covered. So with soil cover, everything comes back. You have the water sink into the ground to recharge the boreholes. You have the rivers flow. You have different kinds of insects and animals living. You have different species of grasses and trees because the soil is alive.
I think we well know that it's the microbes that drive the mineral cycling. We well know that it's the mineral cycling and the organic matter that's allowing us to hold nutrients, hold water, hold air. So a healthy soil reduces pests, disease, weeds, grows better crops. Okay, so that's the environmental part. A healthy soil, then if you have less weeds, that's less time to maintain the land. It's less gas in your tractor to go over the land. It's less inputs, so you're economically more profitable.
This information, this crucial news, is slowly beginning to take hold.
What we're going to do first to kind of break the ice a little bit is go around the room, and if you can tell us your name and your farm name and the type of farm it is. I'm a conservationist, and so I assist landowners in improving their land. And one improvement that is critical is improving soil health. So when we improve soil health, we increase organic matter in the soil. That helps the soil hold water and hold nutrients. So it becomes more available to plants, and you can actually raise your milk production. You can increase gains from livestock on that land. And so it puts more money in the farmer's pockets.
We came here in 1979, and it was totally overgrown, had been abandoned for 15 years. I mean, there was nothing but moss on the ground. It wasn't even growing grass any longer. Fertility was so poor.
Now we have farmers paying more attention to organic matter. Every farmer soil tests. What is used to use the main thing of soil testing for? Used to be, well, what nutrients do my plants need? Again, feed the plant, not per se feed the soil. Now what are we looking at? Now farmers start paying the extra money to get the organic matter tested, the additional $3. They're looking at, is it increasing over time? And are there practices helping to increase it?
Finishing up our 30th year. And here, and we now have lush pasture. This has probably been grazed since April. 4 or 5 rotations through this field right here.
think that another thing that we should be thinking about is the term sustainable agriculture. And maybe it's time for a change, and maybe we need to call that regenerative agriculture. Because if you think about the condition of our agricultural lands, we've reduced organic matter by almost 50% in a lot of our croplands. And so maybe it's time to start thinking about regenerating those soils.
We're not taking things out of it all the time. We're putting things back all the time. We're like, oh my God, we're building. We're building soil. We're building life.
This is saffron thistle. Now, most people would hate this in their paddocks because unless you get it very early, it's not palatable. It can give a sheep bad sores around the mouth, so they don't tend to eat it. But it's got an important job to play in our soil. It and other has a deep tap root, single root, with hairs coming from it. And it loads up with minerals, shoots them up into the body of the plant, then dies. The sheep tread it down into the soil, and we have mineral exchange. And that's what most weeds are doing, is either supplying minerals, and the soil knows what it wants, and the soil will grow the weeds it needs. Or it's holding the soil together. So you can read a paddock's nutritional deficiencies and what it wants just by reading the weeds. And a field of weeds is a symphony of needs. That sounds like an advertising slogan.
Central to all of this is biodiversity, not eliminating plants and insects and animals, but encouraging and sustaining them.
So once the bare ground increases, you start to get soil erosion, land degradation, and it's followed by loss of species. So biodiversity loss and land degradation are the same thing. Without biodiversity loss, there would be no desertification occurring. Without biodiversity loss, there would be no soil erosion except in the few places it occurs naturally.
Agriculture generally tends to simplify the land community. And when you do that, you create instability and you actually then become responsible for all the services that the community once provided for itself when it was diverse. And so that's what we do when we're spending money in agriculture to keep things productive or high yielding. We're actually filling in for what the natural world does for itself.
I was a chemist. I was a soil chemist. I made nutrient recommendations. Here's your soil test. This is the fertilizer you should apply. This is how you should apply it. If you apply it with one aliquot now, and then you do another aliquot in a month, and you do another in another month, you'll get maximum uptake, and cool, you get great crop yield. Well, kind of cool, but with all this technical expertise, farms are still going out of business, still going bankrupt, land was still being degraded, still wasn't economically profitable. So we started looking at decision making, and now we started actually having people change their lives, address real root problems on the farm, on the land, go about things in a different manner.
This year we've had fantastic moths. We had little black caterpillars. They come out, they're called the day moth because they live for a day. And these are another type of moths. We looked for insects. We spent a lot of time looking at insects because the more and different insects we get, the more diversity we have. Every level of the food chain, the more complex it becomes, the more diversity we've got, the more soil carbon we've got, the more resilience we have, and the better the whole environment is.
Sort of
broken down cow pat from the dung beetles. They start eating it, and they burrow into the ground and roll up little balls and help the soil build in soil health. But what's really important here is we don't just have one creature at work here. We've got billions and billions of microbes trying to build soil humus for us. And humus is the holy grail. It's holding our water supplies. It's holding our nutrients. It's got five times the nutrient holding capacity of clay, which is rated as a really high nutrient holding. It's got three times the water holding capacity of clay. So it's our water, it's our nutrition, our health. And if we'd used any chemical at all on our cattle, then this whole process would break down. The dung beetles wouldn't be here, the microbes would be getting affected. And so how do we build a healthy soil to hold our water supplies? It's just crazy. And that's why we have to think longer term and bigger picture. Our own future's dependent upon all creatures.
We want the land to be green so the animals can eat well. The animals are important because we live in this land. I really like this land because there's a lot of trees, there's a lot of green trees, and we're also making a lot of swales to retain water so they can become even greener. When people don't take care of this land, the trees dry out and then there's no more water.
And finally, as the soil becomes healthy, the cycle continues, and the lifeblood of the planet becomes abundant.
There's a lot of pressure on us to perform, and when there's drought, there's a lot of pressure, and a lot of pressure in the supermarkets, and you do hear people in the media complain about the prices, and we can't help it, like, it's nature. It doesn't rain, yeah.
You can see that once the soil is exposed enough, it caps, and this is so hard I cannot break it with my fingers. I can use a knife to break it, and you can see how capped and compacted it is. And the runoff from this, it's just like rain falling on concrete. It's almost 100% runoff. And you get these gullies forming because that water has got to go somewhere. In this community now, rain is absolutely not the issue. Every year is a drought now. Even if we get double the rainfall, the average rainfall, we'd still end up with a drought because most of that rain is non-effective. It either goes as floods or it evaporates out the surface.
You're working with the land. In other words, you're not trying to do everything yourself. You do some parts, the rain does another part, the seasons do another part, and the animals do other parts too, because when you're rotating the cows from one place to another, it also helps cultivate a little bit of the land, so when the rains come, the water soaks in a little easier.
Most of the rainfall in California falls on rangelands, and the best managers of rangeland are still the ranchers. But the funny thing is, so many people don't know that livestock are the best tool we have to manage these rangelands for really well-functioning water cycles. Come on. The rainfall in Central Coast California is unpredictable, and it usually comes in the winter and spring. So every day we're trying to prepare ourselves for the next rainfall because we need to catch it quickly, slow it, and by slowing it, we create life and beauty. And so when I look down at the soil surface, I want to see soil, something that's covering the soil surface. The soil can then hold it with tremendous power and slowly allow that rain to move off to the sea, which is right down below us. And this is the pattern that I'm looking for. because the more opportunities we have to use that water and its inevitable way to the sea, the more life we can have in our communities. We've seen riparian areas on every single ranch grow in health as measured by vegetation cover, cleanliness of the water, perennial plants along the corridor. And so now we changed the pattern of use, and the pattern of growth has reflected that. And so now we have beautiful expanding wetland. We have oak trees that were not there all of a sudden growing. We have lots of different diverse vegetation, perennial grasses.
With healthy soil, we have healthy plants, healthy animals, a sustained water cycle, and ultimately, a healed earth.
Well, if your soil's healthy, if you've got biology working in your soil, then you get uptake of all the different types of minerals, not just a few. And farmers can do that. They can make healthier food. We can put carbon back in the soil from the atmosphere.
As soon as you start turning it around, the benefits are just huge. And they spill it out, you know, from the family to the extended family, to the community, to the local town, to the village, to the nation.
We are now seeking a new sustainability, and that's what carbon farming is about. It's the Western farmer's attempt to redress the balance and find stability and sustainability. And that's where I see us in history. Because we can't go back.
It's just all adds up to health. Health of the environment, health of people, health of animals, health of the microbes. These are the guys that are important, these little microbes. Like, without them, we've had it.
That's why ecology doesn't have borders. You know, there's no political borders for ecosystems, for ecological principles. You know, and we need to value our brothers, our partners, our brothers from China, from the US, from Argentina, from everywhere, as one whole community.
This is part of the way to bring food security into this region, because if you look at the soils, they are not good soil. They don't have enough nutrients. So we're trying to heal the land and make it produce more for the people.
Hopefully we can influence others. We can demonstrate that it can be done, that there is an alternative, that we can heal what we have damaged.
If we're going to survive on this earth as people and take care of the resources that we have, then we've got to be more proactive about what we're doing. And the grasslands, the landscapes, the trees, the biosphere that we work in is a critical piece of that. And so it's very important that people wake up to the need to do their part in that management, that monitoring, that stewardship of that resource, so that the lands can serve us then over for future generations.
I think it's fairly obvious that how important it is. And I have children and grandchildren who you can see over there if you look at the wall. That's a good enough reason by itself, right?
We need to keep the land healthy because it sustains all different kinds of life. It keeps the animals healthy, it keeps the plants healthy, and it keeps the humans healthy, all in different ways, but all very important ways.
The land is just, it's a special place. It's just a really amazing place.
We have to take care of the land because it is everything, the way we get all our resources, and we need it for future generations.
So if we keep the land healthy, then we're so healthy.
Y la tierra es importante porque
I think the land is important because it's good for the animals, and I don't want the animals to die.
The earth is very important to us because if you have good dirt, it will make the grass very healthy. And if the grass is very healthy, the cows will become fat and healthy, and we will be able to eat them. And so that'll keep us all very healthy and happy.
I love the land because of all the animals and because it just is really cool how it works.
The most important part of the land is that the plants that grow on it keep the topsoil here, which allows more plants to grow.
Eventually my kids will be living around here, and I just want it to be the best for everyone.
The land is wanted to all people.
We get oxygen from trees, and if there is no oxygen, people cannot benefit to live.
Land is important because it produces us food.
The environment is very important in our future.
Well, if something bad would have happened to the land, then I'd try and do something about it. You know, you just don't sit back and say, oh, somebody else do it for me.
So we just really do need to take care of it, and now, not any time later.
We have to take care of the land because it fuels our whole world. It grows our plants. It gives us a place to live. It, you know, keeps the wild animals healthy. It keeps the domestic animals healthy. It's basically, you know, the heart and soul of the earth.
Of nature.